That's me, hanging with my most precious gift, my daughter Marin. I guess I'm a cross between a single dad and a single mom, and I have been for some time now. I'm privileged, I'm blessed, I'm responsible, I'm happy. God, I love her. She's the only little girl that I know that while playing dress up, wore my baseball cleats as high heels. Where's her mother? Well, it took making this movie to really answer that question. I don't know, but maybe every community on some level resembles Happy Valley.
The prescription was for like 10 of these Lortab, so 10 pain pills. And so I thought, well, you know what? The guy just writes it with a pen. We'll just get a pen and we'll just change the prescription, you know. And he's ready. Well, what do you mean? We can't write another one, you know. And so my buddy goes, well, let's just do this. And he took out his pen and he's got the actual prescription. And where it says at the bottom, it says dispense 10. He takes the 10 and he changes the 1 to a 7. So instead of getting 10, it was 70 Lortab 7.5, and it looked horrible. Because the 10 was like straight up, you know, and usually a 7 is kind of at an angle, and so it was just like an upside down L for the 10. I mean, it was horrible. Anybody can. So I'm going, dude, you got to be kidding me. We take this in, I mean, instantly you're going to get caught and it's going to be true. He goes, no, this will work. So I said, well, you got to be careful where you take it. So we literally shopped around to find a pharmacy where it would be the lowest risk of getting caught. And so we went down, and there was a pharmacy in Mapleton that we found. We went in there, and there was this lady that was 104 if she was, I'm not kidding. She started pharmacies in the United States. She's the first pharmacy in Utah. And he goes in there with this stupid prescription that looked horrible, and this lady, I don't even think she could see, and she goes, oh, okay, well, you just want to wait a few minutes. She goes, oh, that's quite a few pain pills. I was out in the car just sweating, waiting, and he was in there for quite a while. I thought he got caught, and I'm just waiting for something to happen. And all of a sudden, I see the front doors open up, and he comes out going, I told you, she's so old, she did. And he got 70, and that was the start of this whole ridiculous thing.
So, if you were to look at your history, how many drugs have you taken? Do you know?
I've probably eaten your weight in pain pills.
That's a lot.
Well, you're not a small man, and I'm just going to say from this standpoint, don't be afraid to miss a meal here and there. But, no, and that's just a health issue more than I mean, I remember that one time you and I were in Vegas, and you about killed me when I stepped in front of you at the buffet line. There's no need for that, Ron, because there's plenty for everybody. That's what it is, a buffet.
Weren't you the one who said you gotta get back to this world? Now promise me, now promise me that you'll always be free.
I've lived here most of my life, and there's a lot of things I like about it. It's a safe place. I've traveled around the world quite a bit, done work in other states, but I've always come back here because I feel like it's a safe place to raise my children.
It's a close-knit community. Our neighborhood is great.
It just has a good feel to it, good atmosphere.
Utah's a beautiful state. It's a really nice place to come to. As they say, the best snow on earth.
I'm not Mormon, but I like the values of the LDS religion.
I like it a lot. Mostly because of the nature, you know. We got the mountains 10 minutes away, the lake 2 minutes away. It's a good place to live.
You know, it's really clean, really nice. It's a whole lot different than back home.
Mama, be free.
Well, I would say that it goes back to when they first came across the plains and got here. They wanted to build a utopian society, which is really, really wonderful, and it's the dream of every person on the planet to do so. But the problem is in creating the ZCMI and doing all of that, they were isolated from the rest of the world for so long that generation after generation, they created and defined their own culture.
Utah definitely has a closed mindset.
Definitely.
Very set in their ways, and it's this way or no way.
The alcohol laws here are just outrageously crazy. Describe they make no sense.
How do they work?
I mean, such as, you know, you can walk into a bar and you can't even buy a pitcher here anymore unless you have more than three people in your group. I drink a pitcher of beer, and to me it's like drinking a regular beer to a small guy.
We're sheltered, but I'm not naive enough to say that we'd have no drugs, we have no gangs, that we don't have our issues.
Like in our neighborhood, we were the first black family in our neighborhood, and I mean, seriously, the kids would come over to look at us. You know, and the little boy asked my little brother, doesn't that wash off?
I do think that there's a problem with denial, with the drug use that happens here. I grew up here, I've gone through the school system, I also teach in Las Vegas, and I think the big difference is people down there are willing to face and admit that there's a lot of things going on around them. Where here, sometimes I think people don't want to believe that their community could have a problem with that kind of stuff, and therein lies a lot of what the problem is, in all honesty.
It comes to mind that there is a significant problem, and that a lot of people are pretending not to know that there is a problem.
There's a part of me that wants to say that there's no way it can happen because of our religious beliefs and the way we raise our kids.
Yeah, there is an issue with denial in terms of drug abuse, and it's really hard, especially in our culture, especially with our religious beliefs, how that's looked down upon. That kind of, it's really hard for people, I'm sure, that deal with drug abuse issues, because they don't know how to overcome it and they don't know where to go and they don't want to talk to anyone about it because they feel embarrassed or guilty.
Well, to be honest with you, I just got released from jail today, okay? I was in jail on a marijuana charge, and that was 2 years ago, and I just avoided it till now. While I was in there, I saw major heroin and cocaine withdrawals from probably 40 inmates there. So I would definitely say that's a major influence now.
The methadone, the heroin, the Oxycontins, it is, that's the thing. It's a pill thing. It's not your normal street. So that's one of the difficulties. And I think there's a part of Utah County that wants to say, no, that doesn't exist. The reality of it is, it's horrible here. Horrible.
Let's see. This is still Christmas Day. I had the digital camera. So I took this picture. Right after I took that picture, I saw this little quirk of a smile. These pictures are all taken Christmas Day, 2004. That would be the last Christmas before she died.
When she was little, it was just like a rope tied to her, and it, everywhere Mom went, Amelia went. And I don't know that she ever got over that.
She always understood. We never had battles or fights or anything. We always just, as Michael said, we just got along beautifully.
She got her driver's license. We wanted to go buy it. She wanted to get a car. So we started going car shopping. Well, the car she liked was a little Mazda Protege, and it had a 5-speed transmission. And teaching her how to drive a manual transmission was an experience. It took us probably a week or two to get where she was really comfortable and felt good about it. What?
2 days, and I was the one who taught her how to drive with a stick shift. Yes. But she caught on very quickly.
But the thing that was interesting is she wrecked that car.
We met in ninth grade, and I remember meeting her. We were in French class, and we ended up becoming partners for something. I forgot what it was, but we just loved each other right from the start. If one of us were walking down the hallway and they didn't see the other one with us, they'd be like, where's Amelia? Or where's McCall? And we're just inseparable. We were always together.
Amelia loved McCall. She just loved McCall. In fact, one of the last things we said to Amelia, Michael was joking with her and said, don't you think you've seen enough of McCall this weekend?
And I said that, and she said, you can't ever get enough of McCall. And that was the last thing she said to me.
We didn't plan on using drugs or anything. But I ended up talking to Amelia, and I told her that my parents were going out of town for the weekend, and she said that she wanted to get high. And she wanted to use heroin, and I told her, okay, well, I can get it.
I saw the two girls, and I said, and I had a bad feeling. And I remember saying, I just was worried about McCall for some reason. And I called Amelia up, and I said, Amelia, will you make sure that McCall doesn't do any more drugs? I'm really worried about her, that she's gonna die. And Amelia said, yeah, I'll make sure of that.
We had, I'd asked Amelia several times about McCall and her drugs. Amelia said that she was doing fine, that she was being tested, and she was clean, and everything seemed to be going well.
She just used them recreationally. She would use them once in a while at parties or when she and I were together. That whole weekend was her first time shooting up. It was his first time using syringes. All I remember is just teaching her how to shoot up. And then I shot up, and that's it. And then I ended up going downstairs because I wanted to be with my boyfriend.
McCall had a boyfriend who did not do drugs at all. I don't know how he didn't know McCall was doing them. It's almost impossible for him not to have known.
LES in the church. I'm an Eagle Scout. Good kid in school, got good grades, average a 3.3 GPA. Played football, just a normal, normal good kid with no drug involvement.
Did you ever sense that she was on drugs?
I asked her, I'm like, what's the worst thing you ever done? Like, how many drugs have you done and everything? Just find out. And she didn't lie to me at all. She said, I've pretty much tried everything, but that's in my past, and I'm moving forward.
It's going to be a mystery that we will never be able to solve, because we honestly thought that McCall had gotten over the drugs. Amelia was there trying to help her, and somehow, for whatever reason, she turns around and pulls Amelia, gets Amelia to go right down with her. This came from the police, and so we kind of assume that it has to be some back to it, that McCall and Amelia took heroin. McCall injected Amelia because Amelia couldn't do it.
When you overdose, you usually do it right there and then, because I've overdosed myself. She never told me that she was sick. She never told me that she felt anything. She just seemed like she was fine. We had perfectly normal conversations, and so I just left her upstairs.
And then about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, McCall and her boyfriend came upstairs and found Amelia passed out on the kitchen floor.
And then she started breathing a little funny, and I'm like, we should seriously call somebody. She's unconscious, we can't even get her to respond to anything. She's like, no, it'll be okay, she'll be okay.
The feeling that I had inside was just so awful. Just seeing my friend on the floor.
And Jason said, we ought to call 911, and McCall said no.
I was scared to death. Never seen like someone like that in my life. It's like not knowing what's wrong, not knowing it's a drug overdose. Not knowing how to help this person. Yeah, calling 911, that was my first thing, but I was told not to. And so trying to help them the best I could. It's scary. Just not getting response out of a person, because you've never seen that before, and you see it all of a sudden, it's just like, what do you do?
I thought that she was gonna come back. I thought she was gonna come too. And we ended up moving her over to the couch and we fell asleep beside her. And the next morning we woke up and she was blue and black in the face. And she was gone.
After that, I'm not sure exactly what took place between McCall and Jason. They decided that they had to get rid of the body. They took her body up the Bountiful, up by the B in Bountiful, and tried to hide it. Buried it, tried to cover it with weeds and twigs and all those things. And then Tuesday came, and we had all of the news media were here Tuesday morning wanting to talk about what was going on.
And someone said, did you know they found a body? And I just thought, well, that's it then. I don't need to talk anymore on the TV because that's it. She's gone. And soon after that, South Jordan police came and he sat down and we took each other's hand and the officer looked at me and he said...
It was a chaplain.
Chaplain looked at me and he said, we found Amelia. She's dead. And the shock and the horror of hearing what you knew you were going to hear, but you just kept hoping against hope you wouldn't hear. The shock is so painful that you can't move. And you just sit there as this wave goes down, starts at the top of your head and goes down through your whole body like an electric shock. And then he showed us her picture. And her face was swollen and bruised. And I found out later they had touched up the photo, so it wasn't as bad as what it really was. And you're just going, what happened? What happened to Amelia? Why does her face look like that? They couldn't tell me. They didn't say anything. It was weeks before the medical examiner. It was August, second week in August.
I know, but the police came and told us kind of what happened a week later.
She died peacefully on the couch, they said. You don't die peacefully on the couch and have this horrendous wound on your head. She would have had to recover from a concussion had she lived. The medical examiner said it could have been caused by when she passed out hitting the kitchen floor. I think it was caused by something entirely different.
The cops ended up coming to my house and they asked me to submit to a lie detector test and I said I would.
Monday night, she told me what do you want me to do? Because she had to go in to take a lie detector test. And I told her that night, I'm like, just tell him the truth. I'm like, I can't take this anymore. I'm like, this is killing me inside. And I guess, I don't know if she did or not. And then Tuesday early morning, I couldn't take it anymore. I called my mom, I told her everything, and I ended up going in and just turning myself in and telling them the whole story.
So here's a big question, Jason. What do you take responsibility for that night?
Everything, all my actions I did. I know what I did was wrong. Absolutely, I'm not gonna try to deny anything I did was right. There's no way I can justify that.
And then the next morning when I was supposed to go, I woke up and I told my dad the entire story about everything that had happened. And I just remember being so sick and so sad. I was so scared to tell my dad about what had happened. I was just in a state of shock. And he ended up crying. He told me he couldn't believe it. He called my lawyer. And he came to the house and I had to tell him the whole story about what had happened. And then the police came and they searched the whole house. They dusted the whole house down, and they ended up arresting me, and I went to jail. And I remember the whole thing being on the news and seeing it while I was being booked into jail. And I was so scared, scared to death.
Any time of the year, I'd walk a country mile, a pint and a bag in my pocket, characterized my style. I was wasted, not strong as I am now. So wasted, not strong as I am now. Ooh.
Not make good decisions at all that night. I wish so badly that I could rewind the whole thing and bring back my friend. Since I've been in prison, my father hasn't written me letters. I've written him. I don't know if he's out of town or if he's angry at me. I don't know.
What would you say to your dad if you could talk to your dad right now? What would you say?
If I could talk to my dad, I would tell him how sorry I am. And how I want nothing more than to make him proud.
Do you believe that Amelia did drugs before?
Do I believe she did drugs before?
Before that night.
Hard drugs? No, she never did any hard drugs.
We know that she had smoked some marijuana. We know that she had done some ecstasy. When her and McCall were sophomores, we know that that took place. Amelia told us, and we had talked about it, and we thought that that part of her life was over. So.
And it was.
Huh?
And it was.
Yeah. I mean, as far as, yeah.
I think McCall planned it. Like I said, it was the first time she'd been alone in the house. And when Jason wanted to call, she came up with all these reasons why Jason couldn't possibly call. For 4 hours, Amelia lay there, struggling to breathe, fighting for life, even though she was unconscious. And neither one of them lifted a finger to save her.
How do you feel about McCall now?
I don't think McCall has a soul. I don't know who or what she is. I call her one of the undead. She doesn't have a soul. She doesn't care about anybody but herself. I was told that when Jason found Amelia dead, the only thing McCall could think of, she didn't grieve, she didn't say, oh dear, or oh my, or oh Amelia. She said, we've got to get this body out of this house before my dad gets home.
Back. Ash to ash, rust to dust, and some cobwebs. Cut in the cracks so we are stuck as they all said. Blue skies ahead, or did we paint them all red? If it's already been said, I'll find the words to expose it. All that is missing is a little mystery, so I'll invite you to share just a little bliss with me. A mouth full of soul and sugar in our lungs. A belly full of breath, we can taste it on our tongues.
Heroin or opiates or those types of the Oxycontins can be reversed. Overdoses can be reversed with drugs that paramedics keep. They can be virtually brought back to life by using Narcan and different things that paramedics have.
Heroin is a central nervous system depressant. It basically shuts down various functions of the brain. It is not going to be that spectacular I mean, and it's easy to observe, to miss it. You know, this person may just sort of nod off and, you know, unless you're paying attention to see if they're actually breathing, they may just look like they're happily passed out on the couch.
We're dealing with good kids, normal kids, kids that you never would imagine getting into a drug environment. And they're starting out experimenting with small things that usually leads them into a direction they never would have seen themselves.
I'd sit down with the parents and say, okay, these are the things that you need to look for in this kind of a drug problem. Show them what the paraphernalia looks like and describe it. And usually a parent can get up and walk in the kid's room and come out with a handful of that kind of stuff we're talking about.
Marijuana pipe, kind of cutesy. This pot pipe was actually made at a high school shop. Zigzags for rolling marijuana, very common, a small scale for the personal drug user who wants to make sure that he's not getting shorted. Crack pipe or crank pipe, these little glass vials you can actually buy at a 7-Eleven. And if you look at the front of the desk, there's these little roses inside a glass vial. They're not selling the rose, they're selling a crack pipe.
Do you have any light bulbs missing? How about spoons? You know, these are things I didn't know. I had spoons come up missing. I'm like, what's going on here? My kids aren't little anymore, you know? Yeah. Cell phone bills, yeah. Gasoline, you know, how much gas are they using? How many miles are they putting on their car?
My son designed this tattoo because he wanted to be a tattoo artist and own a tattoo parlor at one time. So I went and had a tattoo put on. This is supposed to be CBB, but I think it's a little infected at the moment.
This picture was taken in Africa, and we had it blown up and had it down at his wake.
I mean, we had a celebration of his life rather than a funeral. And there was every kind of kid and parent there, from all walks of life, from all. Every different kind of dress and every different kind of parent and
that's what he taught us, though, was acceptance. You know, he just wanted people to be accepted for who they are and how they were or how they dressed.
Somebody uses drugs isn't just hanging out in a dark corner with just a few people. You know, it can be anybody.
We were actually in Phoenix. We'd gotten back from Africa and we left him home alone to be with his sister. She was watching him, and David and I were in Phoenix. And he had gone to work that night, was supposed to be home. And Brianne got a phone call. He didn't come home at noon or midnight. He was supposed to be home by midnight. And apparently he had bought some cocaine the night before with a group of kids. He had driven to Sugar House and bought a rock. He came home alone, did the coke for whatever reason, what made him do it, why he wanted to do it that night, because we thought he was pretty drug-free at that point. And he brought it home, did it himself at home.
He was alone.
He got in the bathtub. They said maybe the heat on top of the coke took his life. They found him in the bathtub.
Found him in the upstairs bathroom. Just white as a sheet. And I knew when I first saw him that he was gone. And my son and Bree were out in the car. And the hardest thing I've ever had to do was go out and tell Bree that her brother had died.
Our son was Colton Ben Berger, born April 8th, 1989. He passed away of an accidental overdose of drugs on January 28, 2006. I think his real aspiration in life was to help people. And he'll never, excuse me, I'm sorry, have the chance to do that.
I could probably walk into any high school in the state and find it within 5 minutes. You know, the problem is that everybody's doing them. Kids that were the stoners, people in band, computer nerds, on the football team, you know, just normal, unsuspecting kids that you just expect to be good high school students that were were on these crazy drugs.
I have yet to find a high school, public or private, that does not have drugs accessible and that there is not active drug use going on. If you were a new student in a new high school and you really wanted to find any of these drugs, I would bet that it would take you just a matter of hours.
When all this was going on, I said, Cole, we're just gonna change schools. I mean, it's just that simple. And he says, you know, Dad, you can get drugs anywhere, anytime you want.
And the hill is sliding, I'll watch it steal your will away. And my heart is
This person
praying,
writes, your life brought us life. Hope you're running naked in heaven. I love you and miss you, Kyle.
Can you hear me crying? And I'm so scared. I'm scared of dying. I'll lie and disappoint you all, but I'm trying so hard. And I still hear that craving call.
I'll eat my hat if I find the drug addict that's not addicted to sugar. If you're always on a high sugar food, you know that if you're a little depressed and a little blue and a little tired, all you have to go is eat a bunch of M&Ms and a lot of soda pop with caffeine in it if possible. And so you're already training your body to look at food as a pharmaceutical way to whip a dead horse. And I think the next stage might be prescription drugs. And I think we need to look at it. I think we're a nation in deep, deep distress. If we want to truly help drug addicts, I think we need to look at the nutritional aspect. Is it the mind or the body? I think it's both. And a body will not work well with poor food.
I personally almost became addicted to painkillers when I got hurt because 2 o'clock in the morning, it numbs your emotional pain as well as your physical pain. And then as the physical pain lessens, the emotional pain can pretty much stay the same. And you know, that pill makes the emotional pain go away. And I had a really good doctor and he probably stopped me just a couple pills away from becoming addicted to the painkillers. So now I have to be really, really careful with them. And now I prefer food as my addiction of choice.
How does that work for you?
Well, from a disability standpoint, it's a major drawback because it makes everything I have to do more difficult because I'm trying to move a large body with just half my, you know, with just my arms. And so I love my food. In a way, it's my best friend and it's my worst enemy.
You know, when I walk in and I see 20 different people, and to me, they're just 20 different people. But when you start to get to know them, they're 20 people you love, and they're all so different. And that's, if that could be outside of here, we wouldn't feel so rotten about ourselves. And the guilt, there was a time I ruined a business, moved back in with my parents. So now and then I'd go get a hotel room just so I could go drink. And I remember one time feeling so guilty about what I was doing, I couldn't even sleep in the hotel room. I went out and slept in my truck because I didn't feel I deserved to sleep on that bed with the TV and all that.
Or is that upbringing here? What is it?
Oh, definitely. You know, Happy Valley and Guilt Valley. I mean, the guilt is, my sister has moved to California and she won't come back because of it. She doesn't want to be judged for every little thing she does. I think everybody in this state needs to look in the mirror and quit looking through the window.
Thank you.
be surprised how much gas this uses and how much, we'll call him Greg, how much gas his car uses. I don't know if you can see him up in his car, but Greg's got one of these little weighted deals, and when you're sick and you're anticipating going up and getting drugs or whatever, he takes these, takes his little deal and he does these reverse tricep curls to take his mind off this whole process of being sick and going up. It's just something to do to keep you occupied, kind of thing. Because I'll meet him sometimes, and he's just shaking like a leaf. When I'm out of doctor prescribed pain medicine, then I'll have to go a few days or a week or whatever of doing this, you know? And so it'll be, you know, we'll come up and then, you know, we won't be up here for another, you know, maybe a week or two. And then there's been times where, you know, I've had enough pain medicine to get off of the other stuff and gone a month without the other. And then you run out of that, then you get sucked right back into it, because you just can't break that cycle of being sick and getting off of opiates, you know? Maybe I always haven't been the best husband, but my kids love me. If somebody were to take me today, you know, one thing that I do know will be said about me is that the guy was a really great dad. And that's one thing I'm absolutely proud of. That's what I live for. I think the biggest toll that it's taken, if you want to look at the financially, is losing about a $500,000 a year job because of my addiction. I mean, just going out there and either running out of medication to take and getting so sick that I couldn't perform my job, and then kind of getting labeled that way, and people not wanting to take a risk on somebody that has a problem, and we'll have somebody else in here that is not a high risk. So it's had a huge effect. When my kids get up early in the morning after sleeping well at night, and I've been up all night because I don't sleep well, you know, and they're bouncing off the walls and they're excited to do stuff, and I don't have the energy to get up and do stuff with them. Are you kidding me? You know how much that sucks to have them wondering, what's wrong with Dad? Why can't he come out and do stuff with us? And once you get to that point, you will do anything to get out of it. Anything. We called one of these places for detox and rehab and all that, you know, and some of them are pretty pricey, and you got to go in there with money up front and all of this, and so I honestly did not know what to do.
Is it cheaper to stay on drugs?
Oh yeah, absolutely. And to not only, I mean, just the financial side of things, you can have a pretty bad habit and do it relatively inexpensively, or, I mean, thousands and thousands of dollars for detox and rehab and all of that. And unfortunately, a lot of these places, they don't work for people because they go in with the wrong reasons. And especially in this valley, there's this mentality that if somebody's got a problem, we'll just drop them off at the front door, say, make them better, and we'll be back in a bit. You know, and it doesn't work that way. So we come out of the gas station. We've been praying, looking for an answer, what to do, and I see this sign, addicted, drugs, prescriptions, we sponsor recovery, Happy Valley, confidential. So I come out of the gas station after literally having been fighting with my wife, praying, what can I do? And I see the sign that says Happy Valley Detox, confidential. And on the way up to the city was on my cell phone, calling your number. People realize that, you know what, this, I've been so stressed, or I feel so much pressure, and when I take this or that, I feel a lot better, and I'm able to deal with things a little bit better. You know, now you're stepping over the boundaries of taking it for reasons of pain to reasons of depression or pressure or stress or anxiety, and then it's like, now you're just taking them for any reason. Because you honestly, you get to the point where you don't know whether you're taking pain medicine because you got pain, or whether your mind's manufacturing the pain to take it, or whether you're just taking it to take it, you know, and it's just, you get to a point where it is out of control. It's absolutely out of control. So, Sister Anderson, could I get...
I get some of your friends.
Sister Anderson, I need some Valium, a Percocet, and 4 balloons of black, please. Okay, I'll see you tonight. Are you bringing Jell-O, or? Listen, you old piece of this isn't what I paid for. I said 10 Valium. God, I'll tell you what, I'll be at the bishop's house tonight if you, oh, that's more like it, okay. Don't ever try to short me, you. Can you
Thanks for writing me on my mission.
I would never badmouth or say anything bad about the church. I live for the church. It's my guideline. I love it. But you can't single out the church. It's not like it's a church problem, you know. But are there certain pressures that go along with the church, with religion, with any religion? But it just happens that in Happy Valley, there's a dominant religion, you know. But, I mean, there's no way I would dog and sit there and say this is a church problem. That's not. Is there pressure that goes along with always trying to be perfect and do everything right and being in denial and not want to come clean when you really got a problem? And you know, you talk about people that just have, I mean, domestic violence problems and marital problems that never even come clean with that kind of crap, you know? So it's not a church problem. It's, okay, where do you go?
I think there's a chance we could help him with recovery.
He wants to, and he goes, I don't want to do this and expose myself and have my parents see this, you know, if I'm not doing something to get help, you know. So he really does. If you can just not start, you know, because once you start and you get into this lifestyle and you get into taking stuff, there's no good outcome. There's I don't know if you look around, there's not too many old addicts. They're gone. You either get better or you die. That's it.
Well, there's no heroin or cocaine in Utah. This is Utah. You can't get heroin and cocaine in Utah. That's what they do. They don't cocaine and heroin. They won't deal on anything else. No meth. Nothing like that. They say meth makes people loco, so they won't deal with it.
Isn't that interesting? They won't deal with guys that are speeders.
Yeah,
these
are crazy.
They'll do anything.
Well,
what do you want to do? You want to film? You want to go back and see his pad?
Wait, can we go back? Right now?
Let's go see the bachelor pad.
No, because if you show that my room, anyone that knows me is going to know it's me.
We won't show it until you decide what it is you want to do, just so we have it. That's the whole idea. If you really do want to change it, get help. Yeah. I mean, that's the reality. That's where you live. You can do it. You don't have to. But I think if you really do want to help people, and show them, here is the ultimate from having everything and a family to my whole life is in one piece of crap room. You know?
I don't want to get high as soon as I get home, dude.
You hear that? He goes, well, I want to get high as soon as I get home, though. That's fine.
Okay.
You want to roll? Okay. No, I got to tell you, I am, just from my standpoint, I can't tell you how proud I am of him for having as much of a problem and saying, you know what, I'm willing to expose myself, because he's embarrassed. He feels absolutely horrible about where he is, what he's given up, you know? But like he's always said, if you can help help somebody not go the same route that he has, you know? Say you lose all your money, or say you lose your family, say you lose whatever, and you get in Greg's situation, well, you'd think that he would want to do anything to get out of it, right? Living in that crappy little room of his, well, he'll tell you himself, it's like, why? Why go through the effort? I've already lost everything. I can't lose anything more.
It's probably tripping for you, too. You've never been around this kind of stuff, have you? No? Is that a trip going on that ride? Not really.
I don't notice anything.
Yeah, just gonna film.
Just filming, concentrating on filming.
Yeah, here. Mm-hmm.
There's some heroin right there.
How long have you lived here?
4 years. I've been divorced for 4 years and been in this room pretty much. I just hide from reality. Just go get my heroin and come back and hide. And you know, I got married, stayed clean, broke my back. Went in the hospital, they give me a whole bunch of, you know, painkillers. They don't work because you've already have a tolerance even though you've quit. So it's up doing heroin. Then pretty soon your wife's coming in and you're doing heroin on the bathroom floor. And, you know, pretty soon they just get sick of dealing with it. And the last straw was I quit again and then broke my leg racing motocross. Same thing. And then she just got sick of dealing with it. And, I mean, you can look around and all state in three sports in high school, played college football and baseball, and think of the life I could have had. And many times over, I've kept getting chance after chance after chance. And I'm still doing it. Get a few days and then, I don't know, it just goes on. And then I have such a tolerance, I can do, you know, 40 times more than the average person. Literally enough to OD a band of gypsies, you know. And so, that much right there would OD a person that has never done it before. I'll just bust up my nice room, and then I'll cook up some crack, some cocaine, and put it on there too and mix it. Plus, I just ate 8 Valium. And so, it's hard to imagine why that's so addicting, but, and it's not just the dope that's addicting, it's this whole thing, going up and getting it, the rush of getting it from the Mexicans, the cops are sitting across the street, the ride down, the ride back, you know, making it up, fixing it up. Literally, when I was coming down and running into the house, it's like Christmas. You're running in here so giddy. You gotta get your water, you know? Sad. It's sad.
The more you're on, the harder it is to come off. And the problem is you feel like you have the worst flu, the worst everything. And you're so sick, you're throwing up, it runs down your pants, and you get some heroin. In 2 minutes, you're at the top of the world. And that's the problem, because you're so low, and all of a sudden, bang. You know, because normally when you're sick or whatever, or have cancer or whatever, you're sick. There's nothing you can do about it. But with this, you know damn well, you get some, you go from here to here, and so it's such a big jump, that, you know, that's one of the reasons it's so addictive. And I just hope and pray that we can help some people, and for me to do this in front of people like this is unbelievable for me, because I would never do it, which is, to me, I'm making some progress because I've got to help some people. And I think the only way I'm going to get better is if I help people, because then I'm not doing it just for me, you know. And I'm not showing as much emotion because I'm high. And that's what getting high does, is it takes your emotion. It makes the hurt go away, you know, temporarily.
Well, I'm willing to go through hell to do something positive. Well, that's
well, what and Daniel bitches at me all the time, you know? Like he's high and mighty, that I'm living in this room, and he doesn't realize that. And it's starting. He's getting his family problems now. Got the wife wanting divorce. It's starting. You know, I can see him in me so much.
Put him on a spectrograph, right? Here's what morphine looks like, right? Here's what opium looks like. Here's what Lortab looks like. Here's what Percocet, they're all the same thing. They're almost the exact same thing, you know? So pay for the doctor's visit, pay for, you know, for your insurance, pay for the prescription, pay to take it down to Walgreens, or get in your car, spend $6 worth of gas, and not get the exact same thing, get a stronger version for $10 and a little blue.
When I first came here in 86, drug deaths weren't that common. We were probably seeing 50 to 70 drug deaths a year. The vast majority were illegal drugs. Last year, we did 411 drug-related deaths in this office. Of those 411, 242 were pure prescription drug-related deaths. These are drugs like oxycodone, hydrocodone, methadone. If you add folks who are both illicit as well as prescription drugs, that total goes up to 270.
If you think about it, pills, painkillers in particular, which is a huge problem here in Utah from what I've noticed, it's like smoking weed, which is a grown plant, you know, it's something that comes from the earth. For me, I think that's a little lesser down there, you know, it's like, okay, that grows. It's not like it's okay, but you're not going to be hooked. But people that are on painkillers, they're hooked, you know. It gets you by the bys, and it's just, from that point on, you're screwed, you know, you have to have it. And you basically will lose, I've seen people just lose themselves, you know, someone, a good friend, you know, and they're the person you know, and then down the path they've used so much that they'll flip on you and do whatever they can to get their next fix. They'll just lose their soul almost.
It was not anything you'd ever wish on anybody, to lose a child. Blake was a very outgoing kid, as you know, in elementary, junior high, very popular, had a lot of friends. He was always kind of the leader of the group. He was doing well, you know, until he hit about his sophomore year in high school. Got kicked off the team as a sophomore. Grades started to drop and his personality changed. He just became reclusive. He'd come home and he'd go to sleep. We never thought anything about it. Then we started questioning him and we started looking at him. And once you look at him, then you can see it. You can see the signs. You know, he'd come home and his eyes would be bloodshot. He'd be tired. He was pale. There was many times where I had to jump in between my husband and Blake because he was so frustrated with him. Blake would be high or would have drugs on him. My youngest daughter, who was in junior high, would come home and go straight upstairs. My other son was serving a mission, so he was kind of out of the loop anyway. And we all knew that eventually he was going to overdose doing what he'd done. We knew that he couldn't do what he was doing and live through it. And I was upstairs getting ready to go to work, and my husband came running upstairs and screaming at me, saying, "Suzanne, come down. Something's wrong with Blake." And he was laying on the bed, and my first thought was that he had cotton in his nose because he had foam coming out of his nose and his mouth. And then I realized that it was mucus and that he most likely had a seizure. I pulled him off the bed and couldn't get his mouth open because I think he was still having a seizure. And I remember thinking as I was prying his mouth open that he was going to bite my finger off, but you don't care, you know. And I got his mouth open and started doing CPR on him. It was probably the hardest thing I've ever had to do in my life, to sit there and look at my son who had a gazillion tubes going into him. You know, at that point he wasn't a person, he was just somebody that they were trying to save. And I remember thinking that it's almost okay that he'll be better off, that he's been through so much hell in the last 2 years, that maybe this is a better thing for him. The physician told us at that point that he would die, that we would be taking him off the ventilator later on that afternoon. So to get our family together and to get everybody there to say their last, you know, say their goodbyes to Blake. And it was horrible. I mean, I remember standing against the wall, sliding down it, sobbing, and my daughter was sobbing, and my other daughter was, and my husband, and grandmas and grandpas and friends. I mean, all the friends from Bonneville High, they had to call security to clear the halls because there were so many kids that were standing there crying.
I woke up in the hospital about 5 days later, 4 or 5 days later, and I was in the hospital altogether for about 9 days. They told my parents that I would prepare to take me off life support. And I just decided that's not my life. I mean, you only get one life, and it's not the life I wanted to live.
You know, everything's good again. It's hard. Like Blake said, he takes it a day at a time, and so do we. You know, every morning I get up, I go in and look at him, make sure he's still breathing. And I probably will do that until he, you know, moves out anyway. But it consumes your life. Even now that he's clean, it still consumes my life.
The drug problem has gone through the terrace in Ogden like a disease, wiping friends out and my buddies out one by one. I mean, it's overwhelming. My perspective on it was, I mean, it's only a pill. It's only one pill, you know, once a day, if that. The teenagers would get their drugs there was people on the streets, old ladies, that would get prescribed it. There was people that had back pains. I mean, the one day of the month where they got their prescription filled, there'd be 4 or 5 people at her front door. My whole sophomore year, I don't think I experimented with anything more than Lortab or Percocet. And my junior year is when I started to bump it up a little bit. I would start, doing OxyContin, morphine suckers, and my senior year just got out of control. I mean, I was all over the place looking for it, doing 2 or 3, 4 or 5 pills a day. I mean, spending hundreds of dollars a day doing it. Well, when I was in high school, I would look at heroin as in a whole different game than OxyContin. I've never even seen heroin for the fact that just the name heroin, but it's in the same ballpark. It kills people just the same way heroin does. OxyContin is actually a synthetic-based heroin. It's heroin into a pill.
While working undercover, I found myself almost in a sociological project, trying to figure out what is making this so enjoyable. Why are they just jumping to get in to try this stuff? And we got into conversation of one Sunday evening, we were at a party, surrounded by a bunch of teenagers. We got on the conversation of religion, come to find out the overwhelming majority of the kids around me were LDS. And so I asked them, well, don't you feel guilty about going to church tomorrow? And they said, well, yeah, but you know what? It's really not against the word of wisdom. And I said, oh yeah, well, how so? Well, it's a pill. It's not a big of a deal. You know, it makes me feel good, so what? It's not alcohol. I'm not smoking anything. I'm not sticking anything in my arm. Just taking a pill and drinking some water, big deal.
There are a lot of parents that just have no idea what's going on with their children. And it's not because they're not paying attention, maybe, even sometimes. It's just that you gotta dig a little deeper.
We had no clue.
Really very good at hiding it. I mean, it's not like we're not a pretty close family.
A young lady, recently married, had forged a prescription. She was involved in a car accident. She was legally prescribed Lortab and hydrocodone. She found herself addicted within a short period of time to the Lortab and hydrocodone. So she was altering, she was going to different doctors and doctor shopping, receiving a prescription, but then she was altering the prescription to get her more pills. The pharmacist caught on to this, turned her in. I conducted my investigation and called the house. I spoke to her husband. Come to find out, she was a very key member of the Relief Society, and he was afraid in how this was going to be viewed within his religious culture.
But I could give you a list of so many people that shop doctors, that are at the pharmacy late at night or even at emergency rooms coming up with something because they ran out of drugs. It's unbelievable. And you would look at some of these people and go, are you kidding me? This guy takes them, but isn't he so-and-so in the community? It's ridiculous. That's why so many people are hiding it. That's why everybody goes through this denial and hiding it every day, because they don't want it to affect what happens in their church, or they're standing in their church, or they're standing in the community, or whatever. We can't let it affect that, so we hide in this gray area in the middle here of denial, but he's got a bad back, and that's why he takes it, or he's sick because it, and you know what? And it's just because nobody wants to take responsibility for where they're at. Nobody wants to really fess up and say that I got a problem, that I am sick, and it's not just a bad back or a bad shoulder, and that I need help.
The reality of it is that people do not want to acknowledge that which is uncomfortable for them to see.
Childhood, we were a very, very LDS family, and we'd always go to church. We'd always go to my grandma's house on Sundays and have Sunday dinner, and we just had a happy family.
I thought that McCall, when she was in gymnastics, she was going to go all the way. She was going to become an Olympian. She was going to just blow us all away.
I was on the floor and I was doing a tumbling pass, and I landed short and I hyperextended my knee and tore my ACL, and I had to have surgery. It took a year to heal, and I tried to go back to gymnastics, but it was too painful. It was so, everything just wasn't right. I just couldn't get back into it.
I remember McCall wanted to go to school though. She would do gymnastics too. She wanted to go to gymnastics, and I just didn't want to take her. I just started slacking on being a mom, and you know, she was like, please, Mom, take me to gymnastics, please, please. And I was like, ugh. I mean, it was one exit away. It was nothing.
So I just ended up just staying into school and getting a social life and going going with my friends. And then my parents got divorced, and I was living with my mother and my sister Lindsay. And my mom, she ended up falling into using drugs.
It's not a pretty sight to shoot up. It's ugly, very ugly. There's blood. It's just ugly. And my kids got to the point where they just it was just like mommy blowing her nose. You know, it was no big deal. No big deal at all to see me sit down and do that. Hold on, you know, before I could make breakfast, I had to do my fix so that I could be normal and fix breakfast. Even breakfast, you know.
I'd get a call from the principal when I was in junior high because I never was there. And he would leave message after message wondering where I was. And I was home tending my two sisters without my mom. I wanted to go out and play with my friends and not take care of my sisters.
I thought that using with my mom would create some sort of closer bond, and it did, but it was just in a really bad way.
We wanted the mom that we grew up with, the fun, outgoing mom that loved to do activities with us and not just do her drugs and go to bed.
I was using heroin. I had to have it in me every 6 hours, otherwise I would be sick. I would be withdrawing. And I just remember waking up in the mornings and feeling so sick to my stomach because we didn't know how we were going to get the money.
We broke into our dealer's house, and I remember getting two baggies and then a piece that was this big of heroin, and that lasted us a week. I look back on it, I can't believe that how fast we went through them, you know?
Being in prison is so hard. I've been on R&O, you're locked down 23 hours a day. You only get out an hour a day in the morning. But being off the drugs feels so good. I feel so much better now than I did back when I was using. I honestly feel happier now.
Nicole is in jail right now. What would you say to her if you could talk to her right now, sitting next to her in jail?
I don't know. I would say that I don't know. I can't tell her what to do or how to think.
I want us to have a regular mother-daughter relationship. I want us to go get coffee in the morning. I want to go to school. I want her to tell me to do my homework. I want to come home to her, you know, cleaning the house or doing something normal.
I guess a little lower. I remember getting a cough once, and she gave me some Tussinex. And I thought it was just gonna, like, you know, chill my cough so I can go play ball or something for the night, go have fun, spend some time with the kids, but I fell asleep for 2.5 days. Woke up, all three cards were gone, wallet was gone, part of my clothes were gone, and the kids were gone, and I was hungry. And I'd missed work for 2 days. And I think, wow, every time I get tired of something, she'll give me a little aspirin, and then I fall asleep for 2 or 3 days. She was good, real good. Do you remember those, Lindsay? She'd go, "Ron, here, no problem. Just, I know you got a cough here, just take a little," and I'd go to sleep, and I'd wake up 2 days later, and just, everything's gone, my wallet's gone, money's gone. They've been gone on vacation for 2 days. We just went to St. George, we had a great time, so. Thank you.
I've been through so many rehabs, and I feel like it's just a nothing. It's a, I still am just in my own little prison of going home and isolating myself.
And, describe the Nancy personality before drugs and then the Nancy's personality traits today.
Before drugs? Mm-hmm. I don't know.
How do you feel about your life and your kids today?
I miss out on everything.
What did you miss out on? What do you think you missed out on? Be specific.
I wasn't invited to Lindsay's wedding, my eldest daughter's wedding. I didn't get to see the birth of her first child. I didn't get to see all the things that McCall went through with gymnastics and all the things that she succeeded in and won trophies in and things because I was too busy out doing my own thing. I had no time for it. There was no time. I had to worry about where my next fix was going to come from. And Marin's been the one that's lacked the most of no mom. She's just had nanny after nanny after nanny. It's not the answer. It doesn't help anything. It just keeps getting worse until you lose everything, including your kids, the trust of your family, the trust of everybody around you. You know, the worst of all is just the trust of your kids. You know, where they have to hide their piggy bank from you. I don't care if I live or die. I don't even care. I don't.
Describe the feeling of withdrawing the first hour today.
It's hell. It's something I've never done.
Are you encouraged after your first day?
Yeah.
How does it feel? We're on day two. How do you feel, Nance? No, how you feel really?
I don't feel good.
Okay. You're doing awesome though. It's your second day.
Okay. I was desperate.
I was several weeks later.
There's a piece of all of us, you know, when stuff like this happens, and believe me, I can't speak firsthand, I can only speak as, you know, observing, that there might be the possibility of healing. One is you're helping other people.
and two, in the possibilities of having a conversation with McCall. That you might be able to rise above this, as hard as it may sound, and I'm being very outside the box here, so being to rise above it in a way that maybe you can make a difference by showing the world what true love is in spite of this disaster.
Oh, you want me to forgive her?
I'm proposing a conversation.
I'm afraid.
Yeah.
Not for what you think. I'm afraid because McCall lies so beautifully, and I have all the lies she's told me, and they're right here. And once they're voiced, they never go away.
Yeah.
And if she tells me more lies,
yeah,
and puts doubts in my mind about what I know about my daughter, they never go away, even though I know Amelia. I know who she was and what she was and where she was going. To hear McCall tell me more lies,
yeah,
I don't know if I'm strong enough to hear it.
I never would have imagined I would be sitting here today with you under these circumstances. And I'm sorry.
Thank you.
I feel like I had a hand in the upbringing of McCall, and she at one point, I remember a very sweet girl at one point in her life, and she always spoke very highly of both of you. Just want you to know that, like you were her. In some ways, you must have loved her in some way that she felt connected to you, because she always spoke highly of both of you. And I know there was times that you took her into your life, and I know I thank you for that. And
I don't know.
I can tell you what happened at court after that whole day during the plea hearing. This wasn't my feeling. I had the feeling that Amelia wanted me to forgive McCall, to keep loving her because she still needed somebody. And I fought that off very strongly. I kept saying to Amelia, but Amelia, she took you away from me, and you want me to forgive her.
Yeah.
I won't say it's not a possibility. But I would like McCall to take some steps on her own follow through on the promises that she made to the judge, to stay drug-free, to stay clean.
I know that Amelia is feeling bad that McCall had to go to jail. I know that she feels bad. And I know that she doesn't want or will not like the idea of Jason going to jail or whatever's going to happen to him, because that's just not the way she was. And it's just...
And I got to think Amelia wouldn't want the two of you being held hostage by this situation, spiritually, physically, emotionally.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's what I'm proposing is some sort of a freeing experience, a possibility of that. And if the movie ended and it showed even a conversation of initiating some possibility, imagine what that speaks to the world is all. And it's a beautiful possibility, but it's something for you to ponder yourselves.
I wouldn't rule it out.
Okay.
I wouldn't say that'll never happen.
McCall's never asked us for forgiveness.
Yeah.
She's never come to us and asked us for forgiveness. She's never told us what really happened. How do you forgive someone if they don't seem to want it?
Okay.
I'm tired. I'm tired of lying about stuff. I'm tired of pretending that everything's okay.
Why?
I'm tired of being a fake. I'm tired of lying about who I am. I'm tired of lying to my wife and just stop this whole charade of everything's fine when it's not. And I just want to get better. This better work, man, because I'm going to be pissed if it doesn't.
Who's that up to?
Huh?
And who's that up to?
You guys. So make it work. No. Well, dude, if you can't tell that I'm serious about this by now, exposing myself like this, then you're not seeing the real. I didn't. Just keep in mind, I came to you guys.
It was weird is how fast I got sick. Since yesterday morning, it was the last I took anything, and I was sick last night. It was a rough night. So I'll be glad to get over this. Over going back and forth and feeling good and not feeling good, you know. So we're ready to roll. Just want to get in there and start. I throw up.
All right, so. All right.
Elvis lives and Jesus saves us all. With an old friend last night at a cup of coffee. We talked about all the things that had been going on. Staring out the window and gazing into the rain. Suddenly he called my name and he looked me in the eye. He said, I don't know the way around. I don't know where I've been. And there's one long road I've been traveling just to come see you again. I don't know where I'm going, I just don't know where I've been. And it seems to find me some trouble, and right now I could sure use a friend.
Me too. Do you miss her?
Every day.
not a day goes by that I don't think about her.
She's forgiven you. Do you feel that?
I pray she does.
I think she
has. I love her so much.
All I felt for you the first time we were in court, I felt Amelia's love for you. I felt that she wanted me to forgive you. I didn't want to. It took her away from me, McCall. It was so hard. I did not have her here.
I know.
I'm so sorry.
You know, the pain that I have inside, I just can't imagine the pain that a mother would have for her daughter.
I want to go and be with her. I think about her all the time, but I feel her with me. Mm-hmm. And it's okay. And I talk to her all the time. And she loved you. She always, always loved you. And she always forgave you for everything you ever did, honey. And she forgave you for this. She did. She does. She still loves you. Nothing's changed. Okay. Do they let you go to school here?
Yes, I started school today. So.
Okay. Is it hard? Well, even if it's hard, okay, you gotta do well.
I will.
Gotta do well. You gotta make up your mind.
Mm-hmm.
You're not gonna be like your mom.
No. No, but I don't want to. So, and also we have college and stuff, so it'll be good.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So, you have time to get your degree when you're in here.
Uh-huh. Yes, I do.
And you'll be all done. So when you get out, you can get a good job.
Yeah.
And make new friends.
It's just the dorms are a little different here.
Just a bit.
You look a lot better than you did. Thank you.
I feel a lot better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You looked bad. You're too thin.
Yeah, I know.
Can we have permission for them to hug?
I just want to go back to the way it was before.
See you trying, battling uphill, and the hill is sliding. I watch it steal your will away, and my heart is breaking, praying you'll live another day.
Hey Dan, it's Ron. I'm actually driving to Salt Lake to pick up Kathy. I'm supposed to pick her up at noon, and so we have 30 minutes, her and I, to chat before we go and see you guys. So we'll pick you guys up at 12:30 at the offices. So bring the crew, bring the camera. Today's a miracle, man.
Brother, brother. Can you hear me crying? I'm so scared. I'm scared of dying. I lie and disappoint you all, but I'm trying so hard. Then I still hear that craving call.
Ron. I just was calling you to give you a little pep talk, man. Just tell you that I'm thinking about you, and I know it's not easy. And you're an awesome person, dude. And because somebody's addicted doesn't mean anything. I mean, you're a great guy. So let's stand in the future today. You know, let's not move and stay committed. I realize that there's some, you know, some mountains to climb, but if anybody can climb them, you can, and I will be there with you to do it, my friend. So I did this part with Nancy, and it just took about 2 to 3 days, and things kind of stabilized. It was very cool. So all the things that you have at stake are worth 2 or 3 lifetimes, if not 2 or 3 days. Hey, Danny. Listen, it's Ron again. I'm sorry to keep pestering you on the phone. I'm just concerned. You've had your phone off for a few days. I was just joking about the toilet cam for the movie. I'm kidding. I know you're very sick. You know, sit at your bedside or whatever I need to do to support you. But whatever you're up against right now, Danny, you finally get to step through it, Danny. You got a beautiful wife who loves you. You got 5 children who are standing for you. And this is a time that you step through the stuff that you haven't stepped through in the last 15 years. And I am just sending thoughts and prayers your way, my friend. I love you. See ya.
I think about that night all the time. If, you know, I could have, if I was holding the whole, I was holding the phone in my hand, you know, I should have dialed instead of listening to someone else, but I didn't. And we lost, you know, someone died because of it.
If only we could promise a rosy ending for all. Seems we tend to let our experiences form our identity. People who actually believe that they're sad, lonely, addicted, poor, victims, etc. You're none of those things. You are uniquely beautiful, glorious, godlike, even a miracle. We just all sometimes forget. So when you're done experiencing all those experiences, come on back to that person, the beautiful soul you've always been and will always be. It's a choice that can be made as quick as you up from the seat you're in. Safe journeys.